Friday films, and most of the things that you're going to hear about tonight are on our website. So please take a look at that. We originally, a long time ago, we're going to show a movie called Gerrymandering the Movie. It's an hour and 15 minutes long, and I said to myself, I can't. These people were much more interesting than the movie, even though it's a good movie. But it's on the website, and you can watch it for free. So at home, if you decide you want to check it out, please do that. You'll notice on our handout that in the middle of the page, page one, there are some action items. It's always good to give some people things they might want to do if they agree with what they are hearing. So our speakers today, I'm sure, will mention some of these things, and they're right there in the first page. And then there's three pages of information, and I know Senator Boscola has a handout for people, and maybe you pick one on, up on the way in. If you have it, you can get one later. On a handout that we have, there's a something from Common Cause and a two-page from Fair Districts PA about this issue. Great information on it, so I hope you use it and share it with others. So the goal tonight is to hopefully increase awareness of this issue, bring it to the more people's attention, and what designate what is the problem and what we can do about it. Again, thanks for coming. I have a short 5-minute presentation of welcome, and then we'll move forward.
Oh, gerrymandering. That's a word I've heard, and I hate it, and I have no idea what it means.
Oh, I'll explain to you. Every 10 years, politicians redraw the districts that pick the House and state legislatures. But here's the problem. The politicians that are elected by those districts are the same politicians that redraw the districts. It's the insane conflict of interest, because it allows political parties to choose the outcomes of elections years in advance. Look, say that 40% of the
And
the other 60% are members of the purple party believes that all guns are gay. Now, if you divided this state into districts fairly, you can get the purpose of representation.
That seems fair.
It is. But if the purple party is allowed to redraw the districts, they can join this. 5 purple districts and 0 yellow districts.
Now we can pass a law requiring babies to babies.
And if the yellow party is allowed to redraw the districts, they can do it like this. 3 yellow districts and 2 purple districts.
Now we can give the death penalty to all people named Trevor. The yellow party hates Trevors.
Whoa! That's a proud Trevor American.
Even though the yellow party has less voters in New Statedelphia, if they're allowed to redraw the lines however they want, they can still win. And this happens every election year in America.
That sounds like cheating.
Oh, that's exactly what it is. In 2012, Pennsylvania Republicans lost the popular vote, but they still won 72% of the seats in their state by drawing weird-looking districts like this. And Maryland Democrats did the exact same thing when they drew this grotesquely unfair district.
Okay, this is bad, but maybe it's just one of those things that comes with democracy.
Actually, Donna, the only other country that has a system like this is France.
No. We're not going to France.
So before you vote tonight, remember, many of the results were decided before you even cast a ballot.
Come on.
Thanks, Chris. So now I'd like to introduce Janet Little, who will introduce our panelists.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you very much. It's a real pleasure to be here. It's my pleasure to introduce Carol Puddleholm. She's the election referendum specialist for the League of Women Voters of Pennsylvania, and she's the co-chair of Fair Districts PA. Carol.
Thank you. Can you hear me without that?
Yeah, well,
yes.
I'll be better with that.
Sure.
As you heard, I am the election reform specialist for League of Women Voters PA on the state board, and I also am co-chair of Fair Districts PA. I want to thank Tom and Jan for organizing this event this evening. It's a hot August evening, and I am really impressed that so many people took the time to come out and talk about this. This is probably one of the most important topics nobody wants to talk about. And with what's going on with our elections, what's going on with our democracy, it's extremely important that citizens understand it, that people become active. There was a hearing just a few weeks ago in Harrisburg. Afterwards, a retired senator came up and said the only way any change is going to happen is if there's grassroots outcry across the state. And so that's here. We need citizens to know what's going on. We need citizens to talk to their own legislators, but we also need them to be active in talking to the press, in talking to others, in informing their friends and neighbors, so that there is a strong outcry. Otherwise, this isn't going to happen. When we talk about redistricting, often you'll see, am I blocking the view for people here? Often we'll see this particular image. This is considered one of the most gerrymandered districts in the country. District 7, it's affectionately called Kicking Donald, and people look at it and they say, oh wow, look at that crazy shape. This is of interest to me because I live in Lionel, right here. That's where I live. So I am surrounded by District 7, but it's not my district. And I know there are places in District 7, like this spot right here, that it's so narrow, it's the parking lot of a shopping center. And when I look at that map, I know why that map looks like that. But you probably don't. And it's important for all of us to be looking at our maps and understanding why those maps are drawn that way. So to understand this map, try to get that to go away. Got to be a way to do it. What? Move my mouse around? Oh, there. Okay. So to understand the context, you need to look at your map, the districts in the context of the districts around them and the context of the communities that they impact. So for instance, to understand District 7, you really should look at it with District 6, with District 16, and your own district, District 15. So there's a really artistic choreography going on here, which is dividing up post-industrial urban centers into rural and suburban areas so those populations have no voice. It's very clear. So look at that little green blip under Berks. Who knows what that is? That's Reading. Okay, so Reading effectively is drawn in to vote with Lancaster farmers. Do you think Reading's population gets any attention at all?
No.
And so when you look at your maps, you can begin to see what's happening, and you need to be looking at the context of those crazy shapes and understanding the context of your own maps. This is a congressional district, but the same is true on our Senate districts, and the same is true for our legislative districts. Now, you also need to understand the context across time, because people say gerrymandering has been with us since Jerry, and what was his name?
Bill Brimbridge, Jerry.
Yes, good old guy back in the 1800s. Yes, gerrymandering has been around a long time, and both parties have done it, but something very interesting happened in the last redistricting cycle. You see a substantive difference between 2002 and 2013. Something went crazy, right? So what you see is new mapping technology, new data mining capabilities, and a huge infusion of outside money, undisclosed outside money, in the wake of Citizens United. So what this is a screenshot of something called Maptitude. And Maptitude is a software that many states use to draw districts, and it includes things like the locations of candidates, the locations of incumbents. It comes pre-programmed, fully loaded with census information, economic information, precinct by precinct results of elections, all the way down ballot, going back for years. Very valuable if you want to make sure that your candidate, your preferred candidate, is going to win the next election. The difference between 2000 and 2010 redistricting has been described as the difference between horse and buggy and a rocket ship, thanks to computing power made possible through these kinds of technologies. So there's new mapping technology, new data mining capabilities, and there's also money. Money is a big piece of this. Doing something wrong. If you just want to get to the next one, that'd be great, because I'm not making progress here. There we go. Something happened in 2010, in preparation for 2010, called Red Map 2010. And what happened was the Republican Party kind of caught on to all of this faster. They realized that there was a lot of money kind of seeping into things through super PACs, hybrid super PACs, which I'm still trying to understand hybrid super PACs. It's a way of giving money that gives money that shows up somewhere else and you can't trace where it came from at all. So the group called the Republican State Leadership Committee, which is a hybrid super PAC, was formed to funnel money into state elections to capture control of the redistricting process. Now this is a screenshot, it's on the internet, you can find it, this is no big secret. Basically they said they put a lot of money into the states where redistricting is going to happen on a big level because they're losing seats or they're gaining seats. So Pennsylvania is a swing state, which is a good thing, and we were losing seats in the last redistricting, so we were top of the target for this activity. So this group, RSLC, Red Map 2020, raised $30 million, targeted specific state legislatures with the idea, the explicit idea, of capturing the legislatures in order to control redistricting, in order to control Congress. Got that? So it has nothing to do with you as a citizen. It has nothing to do with who represents you. It has nothing to do with what's best for your community. The money was targeted to flip districts, to capture the state legislature, to control redistricting, to gain seats in Congress. It worked wonderfully. You can read the report. They were very proud. There's quite a few pages describing this in detail on the Red Map 2010 website. Just Google it, it's right there. So that's what happened in 2010. Now, obviously, the Democrats were not happy about that, and they're not going to sit back. So going forward, you can expect, the next time around, the Republicans have already announced they started gathering money. They're planning to put $125 million into this next time. So it's more than four times what they put into it last time. And last time, I don't know if you noticed this, but there was a really ugly tone to some of our elections last time. Basically, what happened with that money, where did that money go? It went to focus group testing to figure out what's the one thing we could say about Representative David Parker or Senator Lisa Vascola that would make all their constituents who love them and know they're good people and know they're doing good work. What's the one piece of something we could twist just enough to make them sound like bad people? And then 6 weeks before the election, those things were rolled out in very slick ads, mailers and TV ads to flip those elections. So there were good people who had been well respected, who suddenly were being presented as thugs, who lost the election. This will be worse next time. The Republicans have announced $125 million, and the Democrats, not to be outdone, have announced Advantage 2020, which will do the exact same thing. They've got a lot of money funneling into this, and again, this is a hybrid super PAC, with money, not only national money, but apparently international money. There are international groups on both sides who want to control Congress, because he who controls Congress controls things like trade agreements, a lot of other great stuff. There's big benefit to controlling Congress, And it's really fairly cheap to flip a local election, a statewide election. So if you notice, we're back to the same district. There's District 7. This is on the 2020 website. Pennsylvania is the top of the target. This is on a national website, but we're the top of the target for this activity. So what's the impact of this? For political parties, playing this game shifts the focus to winning and control rather than effective governance. What matters is controlling your districting. What matters is controlling Congress. Doing what's necessary for the common good, for the constituent, is way down the list. And legislators who don't get that are punished. Legislators who understand it's about putting the party in control, they get to play the game and they stay in. And legislators who say, wait a minute, that's not what we're here for, they're the ones who get targeted. So it shifts the focus. The political agenda then is held hostage to outside money influence. That money that's pouring in is much more than the money that's being raised for locally by your legislators. There's a lot of research that shows that once that outside money comes into an election, those people who are elected through that, their loyalty has shifted. They're no longer loyal to the constituents who did not put them in office through their dollars. They're loyal to those forces that put them in office through their dollars. So the agenda is held hostage. Safe districts make it very easy for extremes to grab control. We're seeing that in this current election. As you make it impossible for the opposition party to win an election, what happens is the extremes within the party, you have to play to them to get the nomination, and that becomes the norm. And what happens then is you have a big defection from the parties of people who feel like they're not listening to us anymore. What's happening on the national level is people saying they're not listening to us anymore. So nationally, in the last poll, 43% of Americans said they were not affiliated with either party. That's huge. That's never happened before. In Pennsylvania, our Pennsylvania legislators say, that's not the case in Pennsylvania. Our voters are very loyal to us. The truth is we have a closed primary, which means that if you're not affiliated with the party, you can't vote in the primary. So we have 13% independent in Pennsylvania. I promise you, if you open the primary, it would immediately skyrocket up to 43%. So there's a lot that is very dissatisfaction with parties is the highest that it's been in known history. Impact on voters. There's basically no effective choice. No choice in primary, no choice between parties in general election, and voters feel legitimately that legislators are not listening to their constituent concerns. So if you look at what's happening in the election this year, 86% of our incumbents did not have primary challenges. So if you went to the primary, 86% of those candidates had nobody running against them in the primary. 57% in the general election will not have opposition. Think about that. You're gonna go vote, and in many elections, there's nobody to vote for. So when people say, well, we have accountable government, if you don't like people, just vote them out, how do you vote them out if there's nobody running against them? So we have high, high voter frustration in Pennsylvania, but almost no possibility of voting anybody out. Most of our elections are determined before the primary even happens. So, impact on voters, impact on minority communities. This is a big one. Minority voters are packed or prepped to limit representation. We saw what happened with Reading. That's primarily a minority community. It's divided up into rural and suburban. There's very little voice. You can probably see the same thing in your own area. It's not so much with our large urban centers, Philadelphia and Pittsburgh. It's the smaller urban centers around the state where voters are losing their voice. Another piece we're not going to get into tonight, but in prison gerrymandering, dilutes minority voice. The Census Bureau counts people in prison as part of the prison community rather than in their home districts. We were hopeful that that would change, but in June, the Census Bureau announced that they're planning to continue that practice for the next census. There's a comment period. The reason I'm mentioning this is there's a comment period that ends September 1st. We've been really urging people to contact the Census Bureau and say, this is wrong, it needs to change. So if you're part of an organization and getting at your organization to write a letter, public comment between now and September 1st, please do. Otherwise, there's a petition out there that you can sign. If you look at our website, we have a page on prison gerrymandering that gives some more information, and the deadline for that is September 1st. But the fact of minority representation is diminished through it gerrymandering. There's an impact on business communities. The small business majority, an organization of small businesses, basically says that they are very concerned that national and international big business has an unfair impact on legislation because of redistricting. Because they can funnel money into capturing legislature. Then in Congress, they can have an impact on how policy is shaped. So small businesses would very much like to see that change. They would very much like to support the kind of legislation that you're going to hear about later on today. And there's a huge impact on policy, because if you're playing to the extremes and you can't vote out the legislators, then what you have is an inability to compromise. No real listening to constituents. Moderate voices tend to be drowned out. Reasonable ideas are not accepted. And then the citizens and community and future of the state are put at risk. I have this one illustration because for years, in polling, funding of schools has been very high on the radar for Pennsylvania voters. Consistently, 74% of Pennsylvania citizens want increased state funding for education to lessen dependence on property taxes. 80% support equitable funding of schools. Does that happen?
No.
No. And what we see is because our system is set up to protect incumbents, the way Pennsylvania's legislature is set up, the longer you are, the more seniority you have, you then control the committees. You then decide what bills come forward, what bills don't come forward. So the incumbents who have been there a long time have benefited from our current system. They're the ones who hold in place the whole harmless legislation that allows school districts in rural places that have lost population to continue receiving the kind of funding that they have while other areas are underfunded. So there's a huge tie-in between our lack of representation and our big problem with funding, so much so that citizens now say funding was at the top of the list for a long time, funding for schools. They at the top of the list now in polling is reform in Harrisburg. That's the number one issue that voters want to see addressed. This will happen after that happens. When we reform what happens in Harrisburg, we will have equitable school funding. We probably not until then. So it's really important that we connect the dots, that we see that lack of representation is tied to partisan redistricting, uncompetitive districts are tied in there, lack of representation, gridlock. These are all connected. And people say, well, I'm only interested in this one issue. I don't care about those. I promise you, until all of these are seen as a web of dysfunction, we're not going to fix anyway. One last little thing I want to mention is legal challenges. There are people who talk about litigation as a way forward, and I think we might have Amanda Hart with us tonight, who is a hero in the redistricting question. In 2011, Amanda, who was a piano teacher at the time and now is a county commissioner, am I right? Yes, I'm right. She was the first in Pennsylvania to be able to put forward a successful challenge of unfair maps. And what she did was, through a great deal of hard work, she demonstrated that the maps that were put forward had an excessive number of place splits. So this is on her website. She's got a wonderful website if you want to understand some of this stuff. She's got a great website. It showed on the left were the splits in the map put forward by the state. She created three other maps with far fewer splits, demonstrating that the splits that were made were only for partisan reasons and were not necessary. So the Supreme Court of Pennsylvania agreed, insisted that the maps be redrawn. The maps were redrawn, which held up the implementation of new maps, which prompted another series of lawsuits, because Redding, in particular, felt like we are not being well represented because of what's happening. So there were new lawsuits. And then the new maps, there was challenge to the new maps because they were better, but they were a whole lot better, and that challenge was dismissed. So although litigation is a way to address it somewhat, it doesn't get there all the way, and there's a great deal of disruption to election cycles through that. And if you watch what's going on nationally, done something wrong again. If you watch what's going on nationally, there are lawsuits in a number of states that are well into the millions of dollars and have continued to disrupt the election cycles through to now. And in North Carolina, they've just discovered it's going to be the next election cycle before they have the final maps in place. So they'll have one election or two with the new maps, and then they'll have to draw new maps. So I guess the point is, although litigation can solve it a little bit, it's a bad fix in general because it's expensive and it's extremely disruptive to elections. And we'd be much better off with the kind of legislation that our next two speakers are going to talk about. And I just want to say, we are fortunate in Pennsylvania that we are unfortunate in Pennsylvania in the fact that we do not have citizens' initiative and referendum. We should. Many states do. In other words, citizens see a problem and they're able to bring forward a solution and bring it forward as citizens. We can't do that. Any change has to come through our legislature. That's a problem. At the same time, we're fortunate that there are quite a few legislators, including two we have here tonight, who do want to do the right thing, who do want to see democracy work, who do want to see this change, who feel like this is a conflict of interest and this power does not belong in the hands of legislatures. So I applaud them, I appreciate them, and anything we can do to support them, we need to do. Thank you very much.
Executive Director of Common Cause PA, and he is a co-chair of their district's PA, of course, going down to our right, we have Senator Lisa Boscola. She represents the senatorial district, District 18, and then that's mainly, of course, this county, and somewhat Midland. And then we have Representative David Parker, he represents Legislative District 115 and Monroe County. And then, of course, Carol Cronin, who's the election reform specialist at the Big Long Voters in Pennsylvania, and of course, co-chair with Barry of Fair Districts PA. I know everybody is going to have something to say next, so Senator, would you like to go first?
Look, when I was elected to the House of Representatives in 1994, this is how I started to get involved and really interested in the redistricting process, and I'll tell you why. It's for reasons that you haven't heard yet. When I was voting in Harrisburg, and that was 4 years, I had a tendency to vote what I thought was best for my district and not the party line. Okay? Did not fit well with some of my leaders. Sometimes I was punished in different ways, taking things away from me, less staff, things like that. But what I heard was if I continued to stay in the House of Representatives, I was going to be gerrymandered out of my district in the next cycle because I was voting against my party at times. They wanted party loyalists, and I wasn't one, and I was proud not to be one. But I should never have been told that unless I vote a certain way, I'm not going to be able to keep my district. I'm going to get gerrymandered out. And that's what happened to some of my colleagues that voted with me on certain pieces of legislation with, at the time, was Governor Ridge. He needed help. He had some good ideas. We supported him. Two of those individuals that I served with that stayed in the House were exed out of their district. Fortunately for me, I ran for the Senate. So they couldn't get me, because I was in the Senate by then. But anyway, so fast forward to the Senate now. In 2000, I had a district that included, the 18th senatorial district, included Easton, parts of Monroe, and Bethlehem. You know, gerrymandered to some extent. But when 2010 came, and the census came, they took Easton out of the 18th senatorial district. And I couldn't understand why, because that's the seat. I mean, it was with the 18th forever. So why do that? Well, there was a certain senator that Republicans didn't like, who they wanted him out. He was from the Quakertown area. And they thought the only way to get him out, they wanted him to retire, was to give him a gosh-awful district. And the only way they accomplished that was getting him into Easton to represent Easton. He hated that so much because he had to travel an hour and a half, 2 hours to get there. He's an older man. He decided to retire. Okay? So Easton's out. Thank God 2010 comes along, and I worked so hard just to get it back because it made sense to get it back. And unfortunately, then what happened in 2010, and this is why I'm so vested in this, because I only have 5 communities in 20 years in the Senate that I represent consistently, even though it's a growing district. It should have shrunk, and it keeps being gerrymandered left and right and all over the place. So fortunately, I got Easton back. But then they needed to move a seat because the West lost population. They should have moved it to the Southeast, which would have made more sense. That's where it was growing. But they decided that that would have been more Democrat. That seat probably would have went Democrat. So they went to where the Republican probably went, and that was Monroe County, and took the northern tier of Northampton County, which again, I had consistently, and they just cut Northampton County in half. So you have one senator that represents Monroe and half of Northampton, but I represent most of Northampton and some odd parts of Lehigh County, which was done on purpose because there's a senator out in Lehigh County, he'll admit it, and you know he's a victim of this too, where the powers that be, his leader, said, look, you know, you have the city of Allentown, we need the rest of that to be Republican, so you stay Republican. So they moved me into the more Democratic part of Lehigh County. That's how important this is to me, not only personally, but how I feel about what's been done to this district. I swear, if there was a bridge you could build to New Jersey, they'd put me there. But they can't. Anyway, but anyway, so that's why I'm so personally invested and tried for so long to get legislation passed in Harrisburg, but recognize, because the leaders don't want this change, you know, the vested interests, both Democrat and Republican leaders do not want to change it. They draw the map. They want to continue to draw the map, and they will not change until they're forced kicking and screaming to change. And the only way that's going to happen is by the citizen uniting and the full force of the public demanding that change. And the only way they're going to demand change is if they understand it. And Carol did a good job. So I'm not even go there with what she had to say. I'm not going to repeat what you had to say. I just want to let you know that when it comes to drawing maps, it's done differently in Harrisburg with regard to the congressional seats, right? And then it's done differently. The congressional seats, and maybe that's why you see how egregious these maps are congressionally, it's done by legislation. Now in Harrisburg, and right now, the House and Senate are controlled by the Republicans, and they have for the last 20-some years. So they control redistricting process on congressional maps. All they do is put a plan together without any Democratic input, none at all. They don't have to because they control the House and the Senate. I'm not saying the Democrats wouldn't do the same thing, but I'm saying in this instance, because they're in control, they draw their maps. All the congressmen were down in Harrisburg, you know, a couple months before the final map came out and final legislation came out, telling their Republican leaders what Republican districts they wanted them to look like. And you'll see that it was all to the advantage of the incumbents. In our area, the Congressional District 15, and I spoke on it on the Senate floor, it used to be all of Northampton, Lehigh, parts of Montgomery. Right. Now, they cut out half of Northampton and even a small precinct in the city of Bethlehem, which you're not supposed to split up precincts in Bethlehem. Lehigh, through Burt, through Lebanon, down to Dauphin. Where we once had a Lehigh Valley congressman you just can't say that anymore. And that's a shame. But even more egregious to me is the Bartolotta district, to call it the Route 81 district. Oh my gosh, it goes all the way up from like the northern, I guess that's like New York, down to Maryland. That's your district. So I just wanted to show those two, and then I can show others, but like, look, you get the point. With Carol, what you said about independence is so true. Most of my friends would rather be independent. The only reason that they chose a party is because they can't vote in the primary. And I know I'm a prime sponsor of that bill as well. So that independents vote in the primary, because I tell you what, if they were allowed, it would shake up this whole system, and that's what's needed. And that's why they won't let it happen. Both parties have a vested interest in making sure that this system stays the way it is. What was the other one you mentioned? There was something else you mentioned, and I'm on that bill too. Because it's all about reforming Harrisburg. It starts and ends.
Committees.
Okay. Chairs. Yeah, and the committee, seniority. Seniority matters as far as moving up in leadership. But I can tell you, if you're the majority party, you can control what pieces of legislation come out and which one. You can just hold a bill in committee, just one person. There's 50 senators. Oh, that's it, initiative and referendum. I'm on that bill as well. Because I'll tell you what, if we had initiative and referendum, guess what we would have in Pennsylvania right now? I am convinced. Property tax relief, big time. We in Harrisburg, because the leaders control everything, because some members are scared of this redistricting process, we had a bill that almost, it was like one vote shot, was 676, which would be the bill that would change the way we do school taxes from property to sales and income. It never came so close, but guess what happened? Two members were took aside by their leaders. One was told to go home, right, and not put up a vote. And the other one was told, you better not vote this way. It would have passed if it weren't for leaders putting the pressure on their members. And why would a member really care? If you really represent your district, you should just do what you think is right, right? Well, not if your leaders are telling you, you do that, and you're gonna be X'd out of your district in the next consensus when they do redistricting. That's why this is so critical and so important to democracy. Because Lomi, when you elect them, you want them to do what you think is right. You want them to work with the other side of the aisle and work together. Thank gosh, I have Senator Brown over there. Him and I are like this. He's a Republican, I'm a Democrat. We work together. We're kind of the types that don't care. You know, we're just gonna work through the valley and get things done. He's in a more of a top leadership position now, so he's under the gun a little bit more because he's like a really powerful appropriations chair. So he's kind of like, I don't know, not as committed to the redistricting map as I am, but I understand his role, and it's our time to just try to do something to break this. And I will tell you, in Iowa, where they have a citizens commission, and this is what our bill does, when they have a citizens commission, those maps look like boxes and rectangles, exactly what it should look like. Keep communities of interest intact, no politics involved at all. And the good news is in Arizona, it was challenged. They did the same thing, and the court said no. The citizens get to decide who their legislators are. So that's a good win for us, because I know in Pennsylvania, the leaders were looking at what was gonna happen in Arizona, and it was upheld, so that was a good win. And I guess lastly, I want to thank my representative here, and there's Representative Samuelson, because I know, and you've been there, we've had bills come through Harrisburg. One of them was to downsize the legislature. Okay? Votes for that happened in the House, coming to the Senate. Amendment offered, right, Steve? If you're going to downsize the legislature, you better do something about redistricting and have the citizens redistrict. Because think about it, what I just told you earlier. If the leader gets to decide which House members and Senate members stay, who do you think they're going to want to stay? Just the party lawyers. So when you shrink a legislature, the leader is going to be able to pick which ones stay. Not the people, the leader. And that's why that amendment was important. And when I put that amendment on the Senate bill, they don't even want to, they say it's not even germane. They get away with some kind of rule. They don't even want to deal with it because they don't want to vote on it. So they find a way not to vote so their members aren't put up a no vote on redistricting. It's just insanity in Harrisburg lately, more so in Washington. So I do believe sincerely that anything we can do to return this government back to the people starts and ends with this process, because it's definitely not fair, and it definitely disenfranchises people, and it definitely causes Democrats and Republicans to, you know, just go at it more than ever before that I've ever seen it. Because remember, 22 years, this wasn't like this. There was disagreement, but this is getting ugly. And campaigning's getting ugly. It's not even about grassroots anymore. It's all about the special interest. And the only way you change it is through changing this process. That's it.
Thank you, Senator Boscola. I'm Representative Dave Parker from Monroe County. So, when the Senator talked about that new Senate district being in the wrong place, I like having it in Monroe County to fix this problem, which I'll briefly talk about. You can see on this map, this was Monroe County in the white here, where, as it turned out, 12 years because the maps were postponed. So, we had six senators. And Senator Boscola was my senator.
Put it on the stage.
Oh, this up on the stage, sure. Right, yeah, do that. So we had six senators, and we had three Republican senators and three Democratic senators, so you can say it was balanced. But none of them lived in Monroe County, and none of them needed a Monroe County vote to win their seat. Now they're all good senators, and we liked all of them. But let's face it, they have these big districts. I mean, if you see all this, and you have two municipalities in Monroe County, you know, your time is going to be spent most of it over here. So, you know, that's what we're left with. And when certain things happen, like when gaming revenue was distributed, we're the only county that has to share half our gaming revenue with the surrounding counties. And that's something my constituents are very upset about. And that's all I'll say about that. As I say, particularly North Hampton, because they have their own casino. But so anyway, this is a problem to me, and I don't want to see this happen to any county. So the senator's bill and mine are virtually identical. We create a citizen commission that is made up of four registered Republicans, four registered Democrats, and then three registered independents, or not independents, but other parties. So they could be any other party besides those two main parties. And I actually asked the question in our working group, you know, why don't we have four independents? And there was a good reason given for that, but I don't remember exactly. But they said, I'm going to go along with what the working group would like. But, and now some people said it should be less because the registration of independents is less. And I like the idea of three because the way the commission works, you have to have a vote from each of the three groups. At least one vote in favor of the new maps. And you need a majority of it. It's seven, right? So you need a super majority or a bigger majority of seven of the 11. But you need to have at least one for each group. So I think it's good to have three independents. If you only had two, it'd be easier for them to conspire and shut the whole thing down as opposed to. But so that's what our bills do. And then mine has special language to say that no county should ever be split up by more than the population. You should never have more senators than the population calls for, plus one. So it gives you room to have two, which is what we have now. We have about 160,000, 170,000 people in Monroe. And so we have two. You could just have one contain that, but we have two. And then for the House districts, it would be no more than the population calls for, plus two. So you have a little more room to work with. But I think, too, if you had a citizen commission, of course, they would just do it better and keep in mind communities of interest, which is really the main thing. We don't want to split up cities and towns and counties like this, because really, you know, there's no one person advocating for Monroe. At times there could be six, but let's face it, if there's other interests in these other counties, that's going to weigh out over ours. So my vote would specifically address splits like that. And beyond that, it's identical to Senator Buskold's. So we were fortunate to get what they call an informational meeting on my bill last week. So in the state government committee. And so it was very good. We had a lot of good questions from members of the committee. And Senator Buskold's chief of staff was there to listen in and take notes. And when we get back to Harrisburg, we're going to address some of their questions and ultimately hope to come up with a better bill that addresses what their concerns were so that next session, you know, we can offer one. We have to get a bill to pass in two consecutive sessions through both houses, both chambers, and then it would go to the people, and that has to happen all before 2020. So it can still be done, and we hope to get it done.
Good evening, everybody. First of all, I want to let you know I'm extremely encouraged to see so many people come out tonight on a gorgeous, you know, summer Friday evening to really come and discuss how we restore our democracy, not only our government, and our elections. Before I get started, though, I really do want to recognize two people I see in the audience. Amanda Holt, please stand up, Amanda. Amanda is one of the true heroes of our good government movement for decades, 1981, 1991, 2001. The courts looked at the maps and said to the citizens who litigated against those maps, you've got a good cause to be upset or misdemeanor as a citizen, but we don't have any yardstick in the law to show how much is too much. Well, Amanda showed them how much is too much. And she lit a fuse, and that fuse is going to burn, and we're going to take off on that. And I think we've got a good opportunities. It's going to be hard work. We're going to have good opportunities to move this forward. We also have sitting in the audience a longtime champion of redistricting reform, Steve Samuelson. Stand up. Steve has been in the trenches in the House for many, many years, helping us try to push through legislation. This, and we've been working on for over 30 years since the 1980s. So I just want to thank you all for coming out and to thank some of the real heroes of this movement. Across our state and nation, more people are getting engaged because people are seeing signs of trouble for our democracy. And what I want to do now is stick to you. I mean, you've heard a lot of history, heard about a lot of dynamics and what we're trying to accomplish. I would like to talk a little bit about the impacts and implications of what we're really trying to deal with. So we've heard a lot from our political candidates about elections being fixed. Well, they're right, but for all the wrong reasons. Redistricting abuses are probably the biggest problem, the biggest fix. My colleagues here tonight have given all the details of what's happening. You've seen the bizarre maps. You've been entertained, horrified, frustrated by what you've seen. Now, the fix to this problem is really up to all you out there. We need you to make the difference. So, you can leave tonight better informed and maybe a little bit entertained, and then head down to the Dairy Queen and have some ice cream and forget everything that happened. Or you can start thinking seriously about what you can do, who you can engage, how you can help slay the gerrymander. Mark Twain once said that politicians are like voters. They need to be changed often and for the same reason. I don't really subscribe to that theory because I know far too many public officials work long hours with great intensity and who are smart and devoted to their constituents and really want to make a better society for all of us. Unfortunately, there are also plenty. You just want to mail it in every day. Sadly, the current redistricting system largely prevents voters from changing the dirty political diapers, from making the necessary changes. So the current redistricting system is so refined, as Carol talked about, it is so refined, it is so precise, that it guarantees electoral success for nearly every incumbent if he or she is with the other party. Computer programs like Maptitude create that. We have the visual of Donald kicking Goofy.
Which one is
it?
Am I doing the
first one? Can you do that part? Yeah, that's good. We don't need Donald kicking Goofy. We'll just put the next one over. So there you go. Here's some other gerrymandering districts. And they're all in Pennsylvania. Can you go to the next slide? Anyhow, these are all gerrymandered districts in Pennsylvania. It tells you what they are. This is from 2002. It got even worse in 2012. And no, these are just a few samples here. Computer programs like Maptitude create every single one of those little zigzags there. And you see on these maps, to guarantee specific political outcomes. Every one of those zigs and zags is there for a specific reason, and that is to ensure that somebody wins the next election. In other words, what is happening with the current redistricting process? Elections are in fact being determined before the very first vote is cast, and we cannot tolerate that after the election. Today, only a tiny handful of legislative and congressional districts around the state and around the nation are considered competitive. Now, unfortunately, you're among the lucky voters here in the Lehigh Valley, because the Lehigh Valley is considered the most competitive area of the state. People in the rest of the state are not so lucky. The redistricting process has made the voters, especially in the other areas, essentially irrelevant in most districts. In fact, for most districts, the battle is not between Democrats and Republicans. The battle has become politicians against the voters. It's all, as you've probably heard many times before, it's now all about allowing lawmakers to pick their voters instead of voters picking their lawmakers. And we really cannot allow it to continue. Because not only does the system make most voters irrelevant, it also means legislative leaders have a huge tool, as Senator Moscova said, to hold over rank and file lawmakers who do not toe the party line. Threaten their districts, they can threaten them with all kinds of related activities to make them toe the line on key important things. And we actually do owe a huge debt of gratitude to lawmakers like Senator Boscola and Representative Parker for not only introducing this critical reform, but also for aggressively pursuing it. I can pretty much guarantee you that probably they are not getting invited to their leaders' picnics and dinner parties where the next generation of good old boys are being picked and groomed the right way. The current system makes the primary the real election in most areas of the state. And if you aren't registered with the majority party in your district, you really do not have a say. That means the most radical wings of each party control the real election and ultimately the power structure and the agenda of the legislature. It means that lawmakers biggest threat is their primary challenge, and therefore they must cater to the most extreme wings of their parties where they really turn out in primaries. It means governing gridlock and the inability to compromise for the common good. Thus, the ability to govern from the center where most people's beliefs and aspirations reside becomes lost. I mean, you only have to remember back a little bit when we had 9 months budget deadline. You can look right now at the U.S. Senate, where they can't even do the most basic job of confirming justices of the Supreme Court and the other courts. A lot of that is triggered by redistricting because they no longer feel accountable to the voters. They feel accountable to the power structure. So this means the issues that you really care about, the economy, education, government, ethics, healthcare and environment, they don't get dealt with because the other issues suck up all the options. Now, I'm really not trying to make you more cynical. Just the opposite. You are now the solution to this problem. The key keys to the change really are in your hands, every one of you out there. Unfortunately, more and more citizens are getting this gerrymandering stuff that they learned about in high school civics, if they even had a high school civics. And you have more and more allies every day. Counties, cities, boroughs, townships, councils of governments, even community organizations are beginning to pass resolutions demanding reform redistricting, to reform redistricting system. Because they are tired of being chopped up into pieces just to protect the electability of politicians. And we put over here some on the table by Fair Districts PA, there's some yellow handouts, model resolutions. I hope you'll take those. Because our local leaders understand that when we redistrict this way, it really damages the community's power base. They know it makes it much more difficult to organize legislative support for local initiatives. Representative Parker talked about Monroe County being chopped up. The same thing is happening in Cumberland County right now. And Cumberland County is the fastest growing area of the state. And it has now three state senators. Probably after the 2016 election, none of those three will reside in Cumberland County. So they will have a similar situation to Monroe County. So I'm very serious. It really is up to you now to make a difference. Politics and government are not spectator sports. You need to get involved. Because if you don't, I guarantee you there are lots of lobbyists and lots of power players with big campaign contribution accounts who will make the decisions. We have brought some of those resolutions I talked about, so you take them. And you'll be surprised. You talk to your local officials, you'll be surprised how few people can really make a difference. The next step of the road of the victory is up to you. Thank you for your time.
Just one last thing, I'd like to call your attention on the very back of your handout and some other ideas and things to help. Network, we're all part of organizations, churches, community groups. Look for ways to get them involved in talking about it. Maybe invite people over to watch the movie Gerrymandered, or there's some good books out there. You can get your book group to read a book about gerrymandering. Our website has a lot of information. If you sign on to our website, you'll get an email with ideas or things that you can be doing. Also, part of the way we're building this movement is through social media. We have a Facebook page, we have a Twitter account, where we're constantly inviting people to engage, and we're meeting other people across the state through that. If you can share that out, you'll help us to build that visibility. So those are important things. And then talk to your legislators. One of the things that the League of Women Voters is doing this year, we have something called Vote 411, which is an online information source for you to find out who your candidates are, what your sample ballot looks like. And then we've asked them some key questions. One of those key questions is, where do you stand on redistricting reform? Some of your legislators have answered and given good answers and have expressed support for this. Some of your legislators blow it off because they're not running against anybody. They don't need to tell the voter what they think about anything. So if you could look at Vote 411, see who your legislators are, see if they've answered. If they haven't answered, give them a call and say, we would like to see your answers on the League of Women Voters Vote 411. On website, because we would like to know what you think on some key issues and just put some pressure on. They're supposed to be responsive to the voter, and we're going to try to make this a key issue in this election for those who are facing challengers, which are not many, but we're going to try to make it an issue that they've responded where they stand on the district reform. So please contact your legislators.
Where was that website again?
The website is fairdistrictspa.com.
Okay, and that has the vote.
That's our Fair Districts. The other one is Vote 411.
Is that 411?
Vote 411. It's all just as one word, Vote 411. Numbers. Vote 411. Yeah. And I think there might be something about that. It might not. Anyway, Vote 411, we'll have information about sample ballots and questions about the district report. So please pressure your legislators to answer.
Carol, there has been one point.
Just one other thing, that on the table, there's also sign-up sheets. If you'd like to be an activist and help us reach a victory on this, please do sign up. We'll plug you in and get you active in your area where it's easy for you to be active. What Carol said is very important. As we pointed out, over half of the elections this year are uncontested. People have free rides. So when they get questionnaires, there's no reason for them to respond. In fact, the response we most often get is, I don't respond to questionnaires. If you have a constituent in my district who cares about this, have them come and see me. We want you to go come and see them. So please do sign up. They will be, we know legislators will be more responsive to constituents, and that's why you play such an important role.
If I could just, on the first page, in the middle, I talked about six things. Number one is join Fair Districts PA, get their email, sign under the petition. There's their website. It's right on the first page. So please check that out.
And the Twitter account as well. Thank you. They're on Twitter. They have a good PA. They post regularly.
Time for questions. How would that be chosen, and how could we be sure that there were no politics involved in it? At least with legislators, we sometimes can vote them out. With a citizens appointed group, perhaps we would have no recourse.
Individuals would apply. Would apply to the Department of State. And we have rules that says you can't have been a lobbyist, can't be an elected official or a family member of elected official or party official, you can't be a party official. So these would be clearly people had no involvement in politics whatsoever in their life as far as paid positions, lobbying positions, even family members put in. But there is a set of qualifications. Obviously we need to know that people have no math, right? And, you know, so there has to be some criteria for education. They would be ineligible if they had elected public office, federal, state, county, municipal, or their spouse. And in the Commonwealth, they couldn't have 5 years before the establishment of the commission. They couldn't be in any of those positions. They would be ineligible to serve their paid staff, into Congress, General Assembly, Commonwealth, registered lobbyist, and served as a political party candidate, official, or staff member. So what we did was try to get anybody that ever did anything politically out of it, right? And then the Secretary of the Commonwealth would then, out of whoever applied, would choose, and it'd probably be pretty random, if you had to think about it. They probably would pick randomly, depending on how many people apply. So we kind of took the politics out of it.
And that's an appointed position by the governor, if they want, or the governor.
No, it's going to be the Secretary of the Commonwealth.
It's random selection. Anybody in the state can apply to the commission. There will be either, in the current bill, it's the Secretary of State, but it might end up being the Auditor General or somebody. Creates a set of criteria that these citizens have to meet. At least you have to be able to do that. You have to be able to read maps. You have to have a little bit of computer savvy. Those are some basic skills you'll have to be a certain commission. Then there are three groups, Republican, Democrat, nonpartisan. They will literally be picked out of the hat after that. So that, you know, the leadership can't break the system. We have seen it work extremely well in California. We've seen it work extremely well in Arizona. And I guess the trite answer is, how's it working for us so far? We have a cap over elections on your test group. There's no accountability.
Yeah, we did mirror the legislation after the states that did it successfully. And I told you, their maps are squares, rectangles, and not changes.
Yeah, wasn't there a state federal law that was passed about gerrymandering?
No.
There was a law introduced. There have been laws introduced, but there's
no law.
Yeah, there's a bill. There is a bill in Congress that would set some standards for congressional redistricting. There are some standards in the Pennsylvania Constitution about equal population. Districts have to be compacting contiguous. We cannot unnecessarily split municipalities, and the redistricting commission largely ignores those orders until Amanda won the lawsuit.
In 2 years, it's the 150th anniversary of the 14th Amendment. What is it about due process and equal protection of the law that I don't understand? A lot of soldiers in blue died face down in the mud fighting for the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendment. Now, I've taken two cases to the U.S. Supreme Court.
What's your question, Vince? Please.
I'm asking, why are we not approaching this through federal law, filing criminal complaints against those who are denying equal protection of the law? I mean, obviously the judges in this state have failed, so why would we not appeal to the federal judiciary?
I'll try to take up you on that. Common Cause has filed lawsuits in California, Arizona, Florida, Maryland, and North Carolina. The suit in North Carolina goes right to your point. There are due process issues. There are First Amendment right issues of freedom of speech and freedom of association. That is going to be the heart and soul of the legislation going back to the U.S. Supreme Court. So you really hit the nail on the head, and hopefully we can get a successful decision out of the U.S. Supreme Court, which will provide guidelines for all the rest of the states, including Pennsylvania and Florida.
I was going to say, there is a lot of litigation going on, and it is possible that with the outcomes of these litigations, it will moderate what happens in the states as they see that happening. But that's a long process, and this looks like a way to get there sooner. Otherwise, we wait for the next maps, we go through the legal process, we go through our own round of litigation as well. But you're right, that is... due process is an issue that is being raised and is being addressed by the Supreme Court as we call it.
Sir.
Yes. For either of these bills, are there any Republican co-sponsors?
Oh yes.
Right.
Oh, definitely. In fact, the working group that we put together specifically is House and Senate Democrats and Republicans, definitely.
So. If we were to look on the websites for these bills, we would find the names of all the votes who are co-sponsors.
Yeah, and I'm the prime sponsor on my bill, and I'm a Republican. But I think there's about 18 on there, which is about even amount of Democrats and Republicans.
And that's what we did it this way. Because I'm a senator and a Democrat, I introduced it in the Senate as a Democrat, and we wanted a House member as a Republican to reflect that this is bipartisan, bicameral.
Thank you.
I'm so pleased to see, this bill being put forward. I'm so pleased that we have Lisa, you and Senator Brown. I saw he was a co-sponsor in the Senate bill. So Lehigh Valley is very represented. Representative Parker, it's terrific that you're on this, because you're just kind of bit north of Lehigh Valley, and that's just great. We've seen how this works in California. They probably had the worst basket case of a government in the entire country. They are going bankrupt. It has reformed their state legislature in a very short period of time. So this is really important stuff, and we can, and it's 100% behind it. The question is, you've got to get this, up for a vote at some point. Have you guys developed a detailed legislative strategy? And who are the chairs of the state government committees in the House and the Senate? Are they going to let it come up for a vote? Is Terzai going to let it come up for a vote?
Terzai?
Yeah.
You mean the one that's going to draw the map?
Okay, your laugh kind of gave me a...
Well, look, but that's
gun violence prevention, we got the same problem, right? So...
Well, look, one indication was there was a reform caucus that was developed in Harrisburg to talk about any kind of a reform bill. And it was supposed to be, again, an unbiased Democrat-Republican committee. And, any issue that you want government reform could come through that committee and get a vote out of that committee. Well, guess what? Bill couldn't get out of that committee. The very one that matters the most. And the reason that happened, the leaders, and I'm talking Terzai, I'm talking Corman, and my own Costa, they had their members sitting out there with proxies, because half these members don't show up, and then they proxy vote, and our sales by proxy. And the leaders thought from the Reform Caucus vote.
Can I just give you a little historical perspective? Pennsylvania is largely considered by academics to be one of the most reform-averse states in the nation. What that means is we just have to work a little harder. I worked on the open records bill for 17 years. People said we could never get an open records law passed in the state. We were considered one of the two worst states in the nation for open records. It took 17 years, but we did it. Lobbyist disclosure, same thing. Pennsylvania had the worst lobbyist disclosure law in the nation. It took us over 20 years. We finally did what everybody said we couldn't do. We've been working on this for 30 years now. Its time has come. But we really are going to need everybody in this room to help make it happen. If they see citizens want to lead, they will follow. But we have to provide the leadership.
You go ahead.
I was going to say that Representative Parker mentioned the meeting, the state government meeting last week. And obviously the chairs from both sides do not want to see change. They have benefited greatly by the system in place, and they're not interested. I was really encouraged, though, that most of the other members of the committee, they were not convinced that this is the right avenue forward, but they had very good questions. And almost to a person, they agreed that the system that's in place is not working. And they all had illustrations from their own corner of the state to say, this is a mess, it's not serving the people well, it's a problem, this sounds very interesting, we need more information, we want to see, you know, how it works in other places. Pennsylvania is always curious about how things work in other places, but our legislators don't always want to do the research to actually find out how it works in other places. So our job is to inform them, and to continue to inform them, and to continue to build noise about this issue, to say this is an important issue, it's not going to go away, we want to see a change, there is a good solution, here's how it works, and just to keep saying that. And I do believe that there are quite a few legislators who are open to the conversation. They just need to be convinced, and it's our job to convince them.
I have a comment to this gentleman.
Could you just clarify the status of the bill to reduce the size of the legislature passed last year, didn't it?
Yeah.
And we're waiting
to pass the vote.
Out of the chamber. Now it has to.
It has to do it. It has to go through again next session.
Because the voters then, yeah, it has to be, whenever you do a constitutional change like that, it takes two consecutive sessions of the legislature. We only have one so far. Then it will go on the ballot for the people to decide. And you know they're going to vote for
us. So on all the year elections, it seems like very few people show up. This is the opportunity to have a movement, per se, exactly at that time, because if you can mobilize people who believe in this and throw, well, should I say, vote out the people who are obstructionists, and all of this could occur without having to maneuver around by putting people in who represent your idea. So the question is, why isn't there a movement to mobilize people on off-year elections when very few people show up to gain your perspective?
Well, that's what we're trying to do. That's what this whole purpose of this is, because there's got to be a groundswell of public support for any change to happen, especially this type of reform when the leaders are so against it because they control the map. Now, look, I can give you one instance. I'm going to say this, but I should give you. I can give you one instance. Remember that? I'm saying this because everybody always heard about the legislative pay raise, which was like 20 years ago, whatever. Why do you think that was rescinded? The public, right? But what else? That leader on the Republican side in the Senate felt he was going to lose his election unless he did something differently and changed that paper. He lost anyway, but we changed it. It would not have come out. He had to be the one to let that bill go, to go back, so that the raise didn't happen. Same thing has to happen here, because we're dealing with leaders. So I, you know, if it were me, I target some of them and say, look, we're demanding this change, It's not going to happen. You're not going to have your seat.
Yeah, so that's my point. That petitions are nice.
No, I don't know.
Petitions are nice, but you can vote people out.
The ones that aren't for this, you know, I mean, first of all, don't just ask a senator or a representative, are you for this? Because a lot of times, they're going to say yes. If they say yes, then you say to them, co-sponsor that bill. I want to know that you're really supportive. Because they can say yes all they want. You know why they'll say yes? And this happens all the time on bills. They'll say yes because they know this bill isn't coming up for a vote. So they can hide. But once you put your name on a bill, you're not hiding. You're supportive because it's on the record. And this happens with a lot of bills in Harris, not just this redistricting bill. I can name tons of bills that people say, yeah, I'm for it, because they know it's never coming up for a vote. So that's why you say to them, or you're a co-sponsor of it, see what they say then. Put it. Is that the right word?
Well, how come we don't have more co-sponsors for this in the Lehigh Valley?
Let's go back to what I said earlier. If you're a co-sponsor of this bill, your leaders aren't happy. Look, every time I mention this in my caucus because I want to speak on it on the Senate floor or I want to have an amendment attached to another bill to make this happen, my leader looks at me and goes, shut up. Quiet. Leave it alone. I'm like, I'm not leaving it alone. But who has the guts to do that? Not everyone in Harrisburg has the guts. A lot of them are afraid. You know, they don't want to lose their seat. I don't have to lose. You know, I'm convinced that the people know who I am. I've been here 20 years now. You know, do you know who I am? You're going to like me or you're not going to like me. I'm not changing much. So I know this is the right thing to do, and I'll continue to do that. But look, you have new members coming on every day, even though you say the legislature doesn't turn over. It's turned over a lot in the last 10, 15 years. And when you're a younger member, you do listen to your leaders a lot more, and I guess they're very afraid that the ramifications that come with putting your name on something. Have you, I don't know if you've dealt with that in your house, but we deal with it in the Senate.
Well, and I don't put my name on a lot. Bills can change too. It becomes something totally different. But we have good bipartisan support on this bill in the House, but yeah, we could use more members. A lot of the Republicans that you see are ones that are willing to vote against the caucus before, you know, what they believe is right. And you got a number of people like that, and we do have a lot of members retiring this year. We know we're going to get a new blood in the upcoming elections, and most of the new people want change. So we want to do it quickly while they're in there before they okay, being in there so long.
Yes. I want to kind of follow up on your question and then your mention of California. Where does one go when approaching a skeptic to show them that the Citizens Commission is worth fighting for, that is the solution, that is the answer? What's a shortcut way that I could say to somebody, this is what really works? How do we know? Where is it working that's effective? Well, as a resource.
Yeah, California, Arizona.
California, Iowa.
Right. And that's one of the concerns that was brought up in the hearing, the meeting that we had. Both chairmen said this commission is not accountable to anyone. And so that was their concern. You have an unaccountable group. This. However, they are accountable to the courts and courts elections, and ultimately the court will throw it out. However, in the cases where it has been challenged by the Citizen Commission, the court will decide with the Citizen Commission in those states. And so, did that happen in both Arizona?
Yeah.
So Arizona, you could give us an example of where it's worked, and if we can find, I don't give a map of Arizona, we still need to show how good the maps are because of this. That would be helpful.
I'm not really sure of the answer to your question, so I don't top my head. There have been academic studies done to show the improvement in competitiveness in California and in Arizona. I'm sure you can find them on the internet. I think the League of Women Voters, and I know Common Cause, have done research in that, and it's posted on their websites, three of those states, maybe both of those websites. You want to give me your contact information after all, see what I can find.
Thank you. I can say there's a study that the League of Voters in California did. It's called When the People Draw the Lines. If you Google that, it's called When the People Draw the Lines. They have a very detailed analysis of what happened afterwards. They have a short executive summary.
And so that's one place. I can also say that there's something called the Electoral Integrity Project, which is an international body that examines democracies. And they began by examining new democracies, looking at the integrity of those elections in new democracies. But then they turned around and started looking at established democracies and were kind of appalled at what they saw in American democracy. In particular, they said the most troubling piece was the fact that legislators were doing the redistricting. And so they have held up as the ideal, the most important reform for electoral integrity in the US is redistricting. And as you saw on that quick thing at the very beginning, internationally, redistricting is done by independent commissions. That's the norm. And the US is really the only place that allows the kind of partisan redistricting that we have. So on an international level, you can say, this doesn't happen in other countries, the kind of maps that we get here. And it's obvious why. And in fact, Canada is another really interesting illustration. Canada was having trouble with gerrymandering, and I think it was maybe 25 years ago, all of Canada shifted to independent commissions, and they've had no problem since. So Canada is a good place to have.
Time for one more question. Sir.
Hi. I'm running for office. I'm in a 26% Republican district. I'm Republican. Last gerrymandering, what happened is it went from 24% Republican to 26, so I really enhanced my thing. I'd like to see the whole concept is the development of competition and changes and competition and ideas. And that's why we need to develop a better process for making these things even. I have an idea that, you know, you could do it via zip codes. Because one of the things about squares is that you have mountains in Pennsylvania, whereas you don't have those in other states as much. And so zip codes are more developed so that, and you could do zip plus four to adjust it. And so it would be a simplified way of doing it, and the commissions would then see a better way to adjust it in a more simplified way. So the goal is to make it so things get competitive, so there's an exchange of ideas, and the best ideas win. So.
We three out of the four spent over an hour to get here. Please help me. Thank you.
I'm in a 26.75% Republican district. But as far as zip codes, like I don't know how that would work, because you know, I live in Stroud Township. Of course, I have an East zip code. You know, my kids go to Stroudsburg, but you know, we have our mail delivered from East Stroudsburg. I have one township probably gets their mail from four different post offices.
Well, it's certainly a combination of zip codes.
Well, yeah, so you might be able to work it in somehow, but I don't know that you can completely go with it.
You know, as part of full disclosure, I have a lot of registered lobbyists. I could not sit on the commission. I've sat in the balconies of the House and Senate for a lot of times, listening to debate on bills. And one of the things that I've always trotted out is how competition makes us stronger, how it makes us better, how it makes us more effective, until we start talking about this. We need to keep bringing that back up. And I mean, I don't want to sound like Donnie Downer here, but your idea about the zip codes, I'm afraid that train's probably left the station, because Maptitude does it down to not only precincts, but census blocks, and in some cases, individual houses.
Well, I was talking after the citizens thing was started.
Right, I mean, computers are here.
Can I say one thing? Like, don't get, like, we have Senate and House bills, but we're not married to these bills. What you want to do is go out there and say, we don't want legislators drawing our maps anymore. We want an independent commission to do that. and that's where it starts. Because these bills, if they even get out of committee, which I'm hoping they will, are going to be amended. You know, there's going to be other ideas, maybe better ideas. This was just something that him and I worked together on with our other colleagues that are co-sponsors. So we had something, something that the Senate and the House could look at. But that doesn't mean this is perfect. You know, that's why we have an amendment process. And there could be somebody that has a better idea to amend it in. But the thing that you say out there when you're talking about this is just the concept of legislators not picking their, the if citizens should. And that's the way this starts.
Yeah, this was an attempt to collect the best practices from around the country and mold them into a bill that seemed to fit Pennsylvania's political culture. So we're actually trying to change the political culture, but we also have to get it passed.